So we are glad to hear Riccardo Treglia, who is going to be speaking about evaluation in the computational calculus and showing that it is non-confluent.
Yes, thank you. Okay, this is a joint work with Claudia Faggian and Giulio Guerreri. Yes, we talk about evaluation in the computational calculus. Well, this presentation must have a back cover. It is worth to say that the work we are presenting now is a development of what I presented last year workshop in IWC 20. Because this work would never have arisen without Fanostrom's crucial comment that followed my last year presentation. And also without the collaboration born after and thanks to the workshop, I mean the collaboration with Claudia and Giulio. Well, in the very end of this presentation, I will spend other sentences about the connection between what I'm presenting now and what I presented the last year. The topic of this talk is about rewriting theory of the computational calculus. As computational calculus, I mean the one introduced by Moggi. Specifically, we will deal with the Sabre-Waldler's formulation that is simpler. This calculus is named lambda ML star. And the results I'm going to present are divided in the first part, that is a negative part, in which I will present a bunch of counterexamples to confluence and factorization of weak reduction that for us is quite unexpected. The second part is the positive one, because despite the non-trivial properties of rewriting, we are able to prove the convergence theorem in lambda ML star. So let's start with a brief introduction of the monadic approach introduced by Moggi in the late 80s with his computational lambda calculus. The computational lambda calculus can be seen as a meta-language to describe non-functional computational effects in programming languages. Since then, computational lambda calculi have been developed as foundational programming languages, formalizing both functional and effectful features. And nowadays, it's a still very active line of research. To model effectful features at a semantic level, Moggi used the notion of monad, borrowed from category theory. In category theory, the concept of monad was formalized already in the 60s, but one of Moggi's novelties was to introduce this concept in computer science. At a syntactic level, instead, the use of monadic approach is internalized by considering the three monad laws that are proper of the definition, the categorical definition of monad, considering these three monad laws as three conversion rules that are added to the usual lambda rules, reduction rules of lambda calculus. Well, we are interested in returning in value, so it's quite natural, it's very common in literature to see computational lambda calculus as a Plotkin called bivalue lambda calculus plus this addition of these oriented monadic laws. In our case, they are oriented. Well, we focus on this calculus, lambda ML star, introduced by Sabre and Waldler in 96. This is a neat, a compact refinement of Moggian typed computational calculus. And indeed, there is a strong relation between this calculus I'm going to present and the original one given by Moggi. Let's see it in detail, the grammar terms. We have a two-sorted syntax that separates values and computations. And also, this is very common in literature of calculi with effects. Values, as usual, are variables and abstractions. Computations are built by different operators. So the first one is the coercion of values into computations. In Haskell, this is the return operator. And we can see this coercion of values into computation just like a trivial computation with no effects. Then we have the let expression, also known as explicit substitutions, capturing the monadic binding. And finally, we have also the functional application, but notice that the functional application is of value to values. Then we have our reduction rules. As I said before, we have the ordinary reduction rules plus the three monadic laws. Before going into details of these three monadic laws, please let me stress that this let eta rule is named let eta in literature, but its behavior is completely different to the ordinary eta rule that we don't consider. So, we add to the usual call by value beta reduction the oriented three monadic laws. The first one is also called sequencing. It is the beta reduction in the case of let expressions that is performed when the inner term is a returned value. Then we have the identity that performs when a term is inside a let expression, but a very trivial let expression where the body of let is just a returned variable, the same that is binded in giving M, the inner term. And the last rule is the associativity. It takes place when we have two nested let expressions, disaggregating them when a psi condition is satisfied. Well, both Moggi's computational lambda calculus and this one I've just presented, if we consider all the rules and closing them by arbitrary context, and I name this reduction the full reduction, well, the full reduction is confluent. Following the standard practice, we define the evaluation. In the literature of calculi with effect, the evaluation is usually defined as the closure of all the rules under weak contexts, where weak, I mean that no reduction is allowed under binders, where binders are let and abstractions. Weak contexts are the empty context and the let expressions. Well, the operational understanding of this let expression is the following. Read let x be m in n. Well, we reduce m, the inner term, until we reach a returned value. Then we bind this value to x and substitute it in every occurrence of x in n. In literature, is also standard to consider just a weak context, yes, but with beta and let beta reductions only. Now it's the moment to clarify that while the literature of computational lambda calculi often adopts weak reduction, generally the associativity and the identity rule are usually dealt with as unoriented identities. The only oriented one are beta and let beta. But now we are considering the identity and associativity as oriented reduction rules. And despite the prominent role of weak reduction, its reduction property for us are somehow surprising, because while the full reduction is confluent, the closure of the rules under weak context turn out to be non-deterministic, okay, but also not confluent, and normal forms are not unique. Now I will give two counter examples to confluence, and please notice that they are given just by the monadic laws. Here are the first one. Take this term, let y be let x be zeta zeta in m, where m can be a normal form like x applied to x, in returned y. Well, here we can perform an identity reduction in the empty context that is weak, obtaining the inner term. In fact, this inner term is in a let expression that is trivial, so we can perform the identity reduction obtaining the inner term. But also in the empty context, we can perform an associativity reduction. In fact, here we have two let expressions nested one together. So we can disaggregate this let expression obtaining this second term. This second term below is in a weak normal form because the only reduction that is possible here, if you want, in the body of the let expression. So no weak reduction can be performed here. So we have obtained two normal forms, M first and second, that are different. Here, another counterexample, and just using the associativity rule. Consider this large term with three nested let expressions, let zeta be let x be let y be l in q in p in r, where all these capital letters are just zeta applied to zeta. Well, here we can perform in a different position and associativity rule. For example, consider first the empty context, just the overline term. We can perform an associativity reduction, obtaining this term I'm pointing. But this term has another two let expression nested. So we can perform another associativity reduction obtaining this term M first. But what if we reduce the underlying term, the inner term? Well, also here we can perform an associativity rule obtaining this term. And also this term is here in the head position, if you want, the two nested let expression. So we can reperform in the empty context the associativity rule obtaining M second. Well, M first and second both are normal forms, but they are distinct. Let's move on to another remarkable aspect, making the reduction theory of ML star tricky to study. And this is the factorization. In Plotkin call by value, lambda calculus reduction satisfy weak factorization. With the weak factorization, I mean that any sequence, reduction sequence can be rearranged by two sub reduction sequence. The first with just weak steps and the second with just not weak steps. In ML star, and we think in similar computational lambda calculi, weak reduction does not hold. The problem here is not the associativity rule, but is the identity rule. And this counterexample was given by Fanostrom as the contribution I said in the beginning of this talk. Let's consider this term, M. M be let y be zeta zeta in let x be y in zeta. Well, here we can perform a not weak reduction here in the body of a let expression, giving returned y. And now in the empty context, we can perform an identity weak reduction, obtaining n. It's very clear that no weak steps are possible from M. And it's very clear that it's impossible to factorize the reduction from M to N having first weak steps and then non-weak steps, because the last weak steps is possible just thanks to the non-weak steps we had before. why we are interested in factorization. And so recall again the paradigmatic example of Plotkin's call by value. In fact, in Plotkin's call by value, and I'm just referring to the paramount work by Plotkin in 75, factorization actually yields the convergence theorem. The convergence theorem say that if a term M beta reduced to a value, that M only needs weak beta reduction to reach a value. Despite the drawbacks of weak reduction that I've just presented, I mean no confluence, no factorization, we are still able to prove a similar result. This proof is surely not trivial, but gives us the possibility to bridge between the full reduction and the evaluation in ML star. Let's see the meaning of this theorem by means of these graphics. Well, the larger circle, the gray one, represents returning a value under arbitrary contexts. Well, by means of our convergence theorem, we are able to prove that doing that in the larger circle, the gray one, is the same, it's possible to do in the inner circle, the dark orange. That means that we need just weak contexts with beta and let beta reduction rules, not considering associativity and identity. The proof of this theorem is, as I said, non-trivial because of the no factorization example. It relies on the study of a calculus that me and Ugo De Liguoro recently introduced, and I presented the last year workshop. This is the computational core. The computational core has the same issues, but different syntax, which is more closely related to calculi inspired by linear logic, whose properties and tools we can then use. So for the computational core, we are able to prove a convergence result, and this topic is covered in another submission to the special issue of the conf of last year conference. And the recent work is to merge, embeds ML star via translation in the computational core, and then reconvert and coming back to ML star again. So our conclusion, the convergence result in lambda ML star provides a theoretical justification to a theoretical but also applied justification to the following facts. Functional programming languages with computational effects use weak reduction as an evaluation mechanism. Indeed, we now know that to return a value, weak reduction is enough, and the only rules of interest are beta and let beta. Now, as I promised, the conclusion referring to my last year presentation. Last year, I presented a preliminary and incomplete work on weak factorization based on computational calculus, and it evolved in an analysis of the reduction theory of the computational calculus, and this work was submitted to the special issue. Now, the properties of the non-confluence and non-factorization hold not just in the computational core, but also, as I presented now, in a mainstream and well-established calculus such as lambda ML star. And we expect that the same holds in every computational calculus with oriented monadic laws. Well, we find this fact quite surprising and worth to be stated. I hope this, it is the same for the audience, and I thank you for listening. And with that, I conclude my presentation.
Thank you very much. So, other questions or comments about?
I have a question. In the examples of non-confluence, why can't you just use the associativity rule again to get back to where you started?
The first example of this one or the second? I've not understood the question, sorry.
More the first one.
Okay, we can perform two. No, I've not understood, because here we can perform just one associativity rule. There is not a critical pair giving with the two reduction rule by means of the associativity from the given term.
But I mean, this bottom term, isn't that also the sort of thing you can apply associativity to?
Alright, the associativity rule is this one from the first and this one below. We cannot perform another associativity rule in any other position. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay, yeah. Sorry, I think I misunderstood what the associativity rule was.
Let's see together the associativity rule, for example, if we want. We have two nested let expression, where the inner one is a let expression here, and we bring back this disaggregating term, and this is the counterexample, giving a critical peak.
Okay, thank you. That resolves my question.
Maybe we can talk later again. Let me understand better the question, sorry.
Is there any other question or remark? So Vincent is asking on the chat, did you try to use tools to find critical pairs?
No, I didn't try. I think that a tool to find the critical pairs has to rely on, to be sure to you have all. I don't understand. I think it's incomplete.
You did not miss any critical pair, I guess you said.
Right, that's the question. I mean, by hand is always quite tricky, especially when you have bound variables, etc., whether you found all critical pairs or not.
No, we didn't use tools to find critical pairs. The non-confluent, this counterexample and the second one was just enough to be clear.
That's true. But yeah.
We wanted just to realize this fact and, thanks to you, the non-factorization result.
Yeah, okay.
Anyway, I think that we should rely on a termination property to be sure to find all critical pairs using a tool. The question mine. It's my question.
No, I mean, I think if you use Hamana's tool Sol or something, you will get your critical pairs. And of course, then you may have to exclude weak, et cetera, but still for the unconditional or, well, without constraint on context, you will get these things. So that could be helpful just to be very quick in analyzing your system, the basic properties.
Okay. Thanks.
And would it make sense to try to complete it or like... in the sense of making a Coase-Bendix completion or to make it confluent again?
I have a problem with my headphone, maybe. Sorry, Samuel, can you repeat?
No, my question was would it make sense to try to add rules in order to make it confluent? So like do a post-Bendix completion or something of this kind?
Yes, but I think it's another line of research. We wanted to find by means of computational calculus and now mirroring in the ML star a neat way to treat with computational lambda calculi. So we want to find a sort of core of the rules that we need to speak about effects. Also, if here effects there aren't, because this is just a way to control effects, but without an algebraic operator, there are no effects at all. So adding other rules, yes, it's possible. For example, this is the case of Herbelein and Zimmermann computational lambda calculi. But I think our approach is the opposite. We don't want to add rules to gain confluence and factorization, but we wanted to analyze the minimal part of this or this calculi. In fact, why we choose the lambda ML star? Lambda ML star has a strong connection with Moggi's computational calculus, since we have a reflection relationship that relates to the two calculi. Adding other rules maybe will break this strong relation with Moggi's computational calculus.
Okay. Thank you. So is there any last question? If not, I propose that we stop here. Thank you very much again.
Thank you.
And
I thank the organizers also.
Thank you very much.